And welcome back to the Beyond Gardens Garden. This is a live television program. If you're watching us on a Wednesday evening, and you can contact us direct and live, and it's simplicity itself how to do it.
Yes, call us 6468 5994,
and turn the sound down on your television, please.
And don't use speakerphone, or you can email tv@beyondgardens.com.au.
Look, it's that simple.
That's easy.
So, get punching the buttons, as they say. This program is made possible by sponsors, and we'd like to recognise their support: the Water Corporation, the City of Mandurah, the City of Stirling, and the City of Swan. All support Beyond Gardens Live, this program.
Absolutely.
Speaking of calls.
Yes.
Speaking of calls.
Yes, speaking of calls, we do have a couple of callers on the line. Well, we have one at the moment. Hello, caller, are you there? Good evening.
John in Greenmount, City of Swan.
Yes, John.
I have a pawpaw tree about 9-10 feet tall, and there's big long stems of flower about a metre long, and also very short flowers up against the front.
Yes.
Do I need is that a male or female, or what's about to happen?
Good question. Good question. Yeah. Cynically, I'll probably get into trouble for this. What we suggest is you put a mirror one side and a glass of beer the other, and whichever way they lean, well, you can work out from that. We'll get into trouble for that. However, what's fascinating about the pawpaw is that it has a variable sex life, is perhaps the best way to describe it. You can get male plants, you can get female plants, and you can get bisexual plants that have a proportion of both flowers. Now, if you've got bisexuals, then they set on their own, obviously. Yes. But if you've got a male plant, then you've got to have a female if you want fruit. And if you've got a female, you've got to have a male if you want to have fruit. The flowers are quite similar. But if you look at them closely and imagine whether a pawpaw is going to appear on the stem, do you know what I mean? You can actually look at the flower and work out whether it's a male or female just by looking at it and imagining whether a pawpaw can appear or not. Mm. Just behind the flower is the part that will develop into the fruit. So that's your best way of telling. But it's always a good move with pawpaw to have two or three plants, even if you've got bisexuals.
Yep, yep.
Still get two or three plants. It's a good move.
So
get another one. But it sounds good. Terrific plants. And again, another one of those tropical ones that not the easiest of plants in the metropolitan area. But they will grow all right. Yeah.
Yeah, about 8-9 feet tall now.
This is a fairly mature crop, and that's actually in the metropolitan area. Just bear with us, I'll take you to an even bigger one.
Look,
over the fence. Yep. And that, again, is metropolitan area, so they're certainly growing.
They've got two there.
Yep. Good luck with it.
Yeah, absolutely. Enjoy.
Okay,
bye.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Bye. And we have one more caller.
We do. Hello, welcome to the garden.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
I've turned my mute button off. I'm actually quite excited. It's the first time I've been able to access this channel.
Oh, excellent.
I live in Rockstone. I'm a member of Araluen, and neither my back nor my knees allow me to plant anymore, but I used to do the tulip.
Oh, well, fantastic. Look, that's excellent. I have to be honest with you, I didn't plant either. I just took the video.
Well, I love going up. I get a free pass. I pay my subscription, so I take all my friends up every time that the tulips are done.
Thank you for that.
What I wanted to ask you about, I just turned on to your program as you were talking about pistachios.
Yes.
And here in Rolleystone, we've had trees now. I suppose we would have planted them 10 years ago. I have a male and a female, and I get actually a lot of pistachios. But the problem is I don't know what to do with them then. I can't work out a way how I get the nut out of the... They have seemingly two coatings, the outer coat and then the hard coat.
Yes.
What do I do?
Well, I think the best thing you can do is to put them in a prepaid envelope, which I'll send to you. I am not familiar with the whole process, but it's usually done in brine. And it is the brine. They soak them in brine, and I think they actually heat them up a little bit. Yeah. And it is that's what gives the pistachios their salty taste, but it's also what causes them to open. But that is really more of a guess.
That's about all I know. Because they
I think this is one we will definitely catch
homework.
Up next
yep.
week.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep.
How to
move from growing to processing. Yep.
I was also under the impression that they have to process them because they can be toxic. There's something in the on the nut or in the nut that's toxic.
I think you might be confusing it with cashews.
Am I? Okay.
That's a follow-up one.
Yeah.
Okay. But we'll follow it up anyway.
So how to process pistachios. That's all right. Okay. And again, where are these trees?
Rolleystone.
In Rolleystone.
In Rolleystone.
I'm just off Brookton Highway, 10 acres. We grew with permaculture and so on. We've got a whole orchard that we had to make our own soil because it's only rock. It's Rolly. We have the true Rolly Stone dirt,
yep.
except it's rock.
It's rock.
But like I said, I really get most years we get a very good crop.
Fantastic.
But I looked up on the internet. And I'm not very good at that because I'm 76 and it's...
Don't worry, we will find out for you.
Yep.
And if you want to tune in next week, we'll give you and everybody else the answer.
Yeah, start here.
I most certainly will. And thank you very much, John. My name is Pat.
All right, our pleasure. Isn't that nice?
Thank you, yeah, that was great.
Yes.
Yes.
On the subject of following up emails, there was an email last week about a problem weed... And it was being sprayed with weed killer, and we recommended the stump.
It was cut lilac, stump method. Wasn't it?
Yeah. The cut stump method, rather, is the method which will kill this weed using the smallest amount of chemical.
Okay.
So the person who fired off the email said that she was spraying it with weed killer. There's ways and means, but this is the way of using
Absolutely.
It the smallest amount possible.
Yeah. Yep. And... time of year?
Summer.
Yep. Summer.
Yeah.
Because it takes the chemical up faster, is that...?
It's the time that treatment is most effective.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. All right. I think that's just about all our catch-ups. Oh, no, I've got one more, actually, while we're at it, rather than delay it for another week. We had a caller last week from a gentleman inquiring about the curry leaf tree, and we did give the name, but he said, where does it come from? Well, I had to go and look that up. I can tell you that if you're growing the curry leaf tree, which is Murraya, some people say Murraya, but I'm told that since it's named after Mr. Murray, it should be pronounced Murraya. Murraya conigii, and it grows naturally in southern parts of India and Sri Lanka.
There we go.
Okay.
Okay, well, we've talked a lot about plants tonight, but on Sunday's Environment Day at Balladura, we had the fortune of playing around with some animals from the Native Animal Rescue Group. So, this is what we got up to.
It's very important from a community perspective that people are aware that Native Animal Rescue exists. We are 5 minutes down the road from Balladura, so inviting the public to come along, be involved with our animals, get involved with our work is part of our community interaction with the City of Swan and our community that we're working.
Yeah.
Put your hand here. All right. You just touch.
Okay,
just touch. No. Okay.
El, you've got him in the perfect position. Just.
Am I the guinea pig?
No.
I just keep away from the guinea pigs.
You need a reptile license, though.
Yeah. But it'll have to be in your name.
Ollie has one.
Yeah, I know.
They're amazing.
They'll fall off here, mate.
The humble bobtail doesn't write much of a story, but if he's in your backyard, you need to leave him there and look after him. He's not dangerous, doesn't hurt anybody, removes snails, loves strawberries. We just need to love them and leave them where they are.
I'm not sure that's a good wrap for
Bob Dalrymple.
Loves strawberries. So do Marin, by the way. We discovered that a while ago. But the trouble with bobtails, the trouble bobtails have in the metropolitan area, you'd probably have them at your place, wouldn't you, is that their range is much bigger than the average backyard. Yeah. And instead of open picket fences, we now have Super 6 fences.
Super 6 and low to the ground.
And low to the ground, so we have solid barriers. So the best thing you can do from the bobtails perspective is to get a sledgehammer and knock a hole at ground level in the fence.
And don't go too hard on the manicuring of the garden. They really like a little bit of a bushy area to get in and shelter.
We've got a little unofficial contest for you. Have a look at this picture and see if you can spot the bobtail.
Spot the bobtail, Tom.
Spot the bobtail. Not easy, is it? I can make it a bit easier for you.
And that photograph is a classic illustration as to why they get run over by lawnmowers and whippersnippers and the like, because they are just, they camouflage perfectly.
So good, so, isn't it? It's so good. Mind you, when you see them close up, you know, there they are, doing very well indeed.
So there's a range of things we can do to look after wildlife in our own gardens.
Yep.
And a very simple thing we can do is just to provide water. Like your bird bath, John.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
It's all
beautifully
it is,
entertaining. Just bobtails like a bit of water as well.
Well, anything.
Exactly. And unfortunately, a lot of people make the mistake of thinking that they need to put out food for the native animals, and that's probably one of the worst things you can do.
Just provide
the water and then put in those native plants, and they'll come for the food that they want to eat.
And provide cover. And be very careful about the chemicals you're chucking around the place.
Well, we do something on our team called bioscaping, and that's good because it brings in wildlife, focuses on local native plants to encourage wildlife. Also, we're trying to get a bit of a yield for ourselves, so we're looking at local native food plants especially, and general Australian food plants. And we just put in a front verge in the western suburbs just last week, and we put in a local native yam and the Kalgoorlie fruit. You got a photo of the
give me enough notice we'll
the
get there.
Fruit that Kalgoorlie is named after.
Took me several years to adapt to the name change, Steve, but here we go. All right. It should be up there now. And that is a fruit. Here it is on the vine. And the vine itself, interesting story. Let me just flick through a couple of pictures. Bear with us. Here we go. So the vine is a very weak, scrambling vine. And Steve and I were taken to a place where they said, it's here, right? Mm-hmm. How long did it take us to find it?
Well, we were taken to the bush it was growing on, and it took us a wee while.
Once you get your eye in, it's quite easy. This is the plant, as Steve said, Kalgoorlie is named
after. Very beautiful
plant
when you crack it open.
There we are.
It's called a silky pear by some people. Yep. And, look, it's gorgeous. Those individual seeds puff up and fly away and they grow somewhere else. But when they're all packed in like that, it's really silky and beautiful. And we also put in a local native yam, which is another sort of light, scrambling climber.
You did this on the verge?
Yeah. Amongst a couple of other sort of little snack berries.
Well, let me see if I can find a picture of what we're talking about here. That's probably... have I done the wrong thing? There we go. I have done the wrong thing. It's okay. That's Wareen, isn't it?
Yeah, that's what we call it? That's the lady yam right there.
Yeah.
Because this is male and female as well, and that's the yam in fruit. Beautiful angular fruit.
And interestingly... going bush with Steve is always a bit of a challenging exercise because he says, eat this, eat that. You can actually eat this, can't you?
Yes.
It's sort of... Yes. I'm not sure I want to eat a lot.
But the main game is the yam.
It tasted like pea.
Slimy peas. If that was all it was, then no one would be interested in it. No. There's a couple of really cool...
But what was also interesting was how deep the yam was.
Yeah, they can go... I grow mine in pots, so I don't have to bother with digging.
There you go. That's the easy
way. That's the secret.
We have a caller on the line, and we'd love to say hello, so we'll do it. Hello. Welcome to Beyond Gardens Live.
Yeah, hi. My name is Tony from Bullsbrook in North Perth. I'm interested in putting in a vine to grow kiwi fruit.
Right.
Yes.
How will that get on in where we are, please?
Oh, good question.
You're in Bullsbrook.
I think you'd probably be all right.
It will grow. Production-wise is another story. But, yeah, it will certainly grow. I had them growing in Joondalup up until about 6 months ago,
mm-hmm.
And I've actually removed them for another reason, which was a shame. But the kiwi fruit are growing elsewhere now. So, we didn't get it to production stage, unfortunately. So, it's a bit hit and miss, the production. They need the chill.
Well, again, male, female plants.
Yep.
One male, for about every 40 or 50 females, of that sort of proportion.
Yes.
The male plant is extremely vigorous and has to be restrained with a pair of secateurs, I hasten to add. But the commercial growers prefer the cooler conditions. That's why, right opposite where you live, up on the hills, are commercial producers of kiwi fruit. Now, another one thing I'm getting into trouble for. Why? I have ever really liked kiwi fruit.
I love them.
Gooseberry, actually. I should call it Chinese gooseberry. That's what it really is until the kiwis renamed it. Chinese gooseberry.
Let's have a look at an email.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. One other question.
Yes.
Yes.
Can you get kumara plants anywhere in WA, please?
Kuma. Can you spell that, please?
Kumara. It's from New Zealand.
That's a sweet potato.
That's what it is.
Orange-fleshed sweet potato.
Mm.
Yes.
In my experience, the New Zealanders I know call the standard old orange-fleshed sweet potato kumara. So.
I know you can, Tony, get that specific one, but you've basically got to hook up with some New Zealanders.
Couldn't you just go to the supermarket and buy one?
Yes, absolutely.
No, I don't know.
Oh, no,
where
you can't.
I did get one from a New Zealander, and it is now growing in my old house. So hopefully the new owners are feasting on New Zealand sweet potato.
Mm.
But yes, you can get it, but I've only known of getting it through a New Zealander that's actually growing it. So at some point, somebody's smuggled some in, which we certainly don't encourage anyone to do.
So, no, but many of these things, once around, I think by the sound of it, it's going to get more common.
Yes.
So if anybody has kumara and they want to give it to you, I suggest they drive to Bullsbrook and yell out, Tony, okay?
Well, they could go on the forum.
Thank you, Steve. Yeah. Would you tell people how to do that?
Well, you can go to www.beyondgardens.com.au and then go off to the forum. I think it's in the top right hand
social network first.
And then you've got a choice between Facebook and the forum, and there you go. You can ask your questions, share your triumphs, all sorts of things.
Yep. So there you go. You can do
if anyone has kumara, then get on there and let us know.
I could do a midnight reconnaissance back to my old house maybe.
Yeah. I learned something today. I just thought it was New Zealand for sweet potatoes. So. Good.
Yeah, these New Zealanders, they rename things all the time. That's the trouble. But it's good marketing.
Yep.
Good marketing with the kiwi fruit, because up till then, almost nobody grew the Chinese gooseberry.
Yep. Keep an eye out, Tony, and hopefully you'll be okay.
All right, good luck with that, Tony. And if you have a similar issue trying to find a plant, perhaps you too might like to try our website and the forums there. So, beyondgardens.com.au.
Yep.
Oh, there it is.
Yep,
oh, look,
there we
aren't
go.
They good,
yep.
eh? Aren't they good? So under social there,
social
you
network.
Will find the social network, you'll find the forums.
Yep, absolutely.
Okay.
And probably a nice little segue into sweet potatoes. We have an email from Dominique in Rockingham. She has a sweet potato. It looks as though they have chicken pox. Can you tell me what the problem is and how to fix it?
Well, I can be sure it's not chicken pox. Potato pox, maybe.
Yeah.
Yes, we do have, and thank you for sending the picture as well, because that makes all the difference in the world.
Yeah, absolutely.
So here we're looking at the swollen root, and it's got black. Now, to me, it looks like they might be eaten away, is that?
I'm putting money on it's been eaten, more than likely.
Rather than fungal or anything else.
Yes, and... the black
What's your sweet potato?
Something
with a sweet tooth.
It looks like it could be probably from one of the curl grubs, one of those sort of those grubs that you see in the soil. I don't want to say African black beetle grubs, but
well, it could be the larvae.
The curl grubs is usually one of the first ones. Mole crickets, as you mentioned earlier, John, do a different sort of damage.
Yeah, mole crickets tend to go in a straight line. Whatever they hit, they just go through and boomf.
Probably, what can you do about it? I wouldn't be too concerned about that much damage.
Steve's going to tell us. I think it's an excellent solution. Steve?
Don't eat the holes.
Don't eat the holes. There you go.
Eat the rest. Don't eat the holes.
Yep. So, and that's really, it's a cosmetic damage.
It's
nothing that can hurt you.
Still be fine. Still be good. Yep. Okay, so that's emails, calls.
Yes, emails.
Now, we must have more emails there because they always bank up at this time. Let's deal with those while we have a chance. If you get on the phone quickly, you might just get through. The number is 64685994, and please don't forget to turn down the sound on your television.
Exactly.
Emails, John.
Okay, we have a quick one from Jean in Kallaroo. After trying for 3 years to grow a good crop of lovely sweet peas, first year they put them in the garden, it was very good. Shoots came up and rewarded me with a couple of flowers. Last year they grew to pots to about 30 centimetres, then died with no flowers. This year, after sowing 3 packets of seeds in different pots and garden beds, only 5 shoots have survived so far. Any tips? Or alternatively, where can I buy them, as I have rarely seen them in florists?
Sweet peas are one of those plants that are usually pretty happy in our soil, because one thing they really do like is alkaline soil. And one thing we've got plenty of is alkaline soil. Yep. What they don't like is being overwatered, particularly when you've just sown them. That's a recipe for disaster with sweet pea. The other important point about sweet peas is you often, when you buy a seed is the only way to get them, by the way. When you buy a packet of mixed colours, a lot of people throw away the small ones. Small ones are the best ones because they are usually the ones that produce the flowers with the most intense colour. So sow them. You can treat the soil with a bit of wood ash if you like, just to boost the alkalinity a bit. Be very careful. Water the ground perhaps and then don't water again. Let them come right up. Give them plenty of air, plenty of support. You can begin to feed them, certainly, almost as soon as they start. And there are a staggering range of them, although they do tend to do better perhaps in some other climates than ours. I'll just flick through and show you what they look like when you're grown up as support. This is the sort of display you will get out of it. Stunning display. And of course, I was going to say beautifully fragrant, but not always. No. Some of the new ones are all looks and no fragrance.
And they're certainly not food.
Can't eat them.
Well, you can, but you get damaged.
That's all right. I'll rephrase that. Yeah. Eating is not recommended.
Yep.
Yep.
There we go.
Direct answer, seed is the only way to go. And people, there is this belief that you should plant them on Anzac Day.
I heard St. Patrick's Day.
St. Patrick's Day, Anzac Day.
It's not that far off. There we go. No, it's not.
Yep. Somewhere around about then.
So,
do we have a call?
Yes, I think we do have a call.
Hello, welcome to Beyond Gardens Live. Are you live? Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
I live in Bayswater and I have acquired a rosella plant. It's a grafted rosella. And I'm really not sure how to treat it. As it being a hibiscus, do I treat it as a native or do I just treat it as a normal plant with regard to feeding?
You treat it as a real wuss. Because the rosellas are not native, at least most of the rosellas we have are not native. This is what the flower and the fruit is like, but they are a tropical hibiscus.
Yeah.
We do have a native rosella, but it too is tropical, so they need all the warmth in the world. The warmest spot you can find, I would keep them in a pot, and I would put them in a nice warm spot in winter to get them through winter. Otherwise, I'm afraid you're going to lose them. Says he, speaking with personal experience, because I've got 6 that are just about at death's door right now.
Oh, no. Mine's doing quite well.
Rats. With regard to potting them on, because I bought it as quite a small seedling, any particular soil mix?
Oh, just a good quality potting mix. Look for one with the quality ticks on it, the Australian standards. That's all, nothing special.
Excellent.
Yep. Okay. Right. All right, good
Thank
luck with it.
Thank you very much.
Keep it warm.
Hope you do better than me.
Sorry to rub that one in.
Yeah, okay. No, it's all right.
Okay. Yeah, on the north side is certainly the way to go. And as John said, in the pots. Okay, that's our last caller for this evening and our last email. We're getting a bit strapped for time here.
I don't believe we've run out of emails.
We'll try
and get to those.
Yes, we will.
Later if we can. And we'll catch up as much as we can.
Yeah,
so we do need to point out that there are some events coming up. Now, I just need to make sure I do all this properly, otherwise we get into trouble. Here we go. Not many, mind you, not many. Just a couple. Steve, you're doing a beach bushfoot. I know this is wrong, and we're rubbing it in, and it's booked out solid, but just keep your eye on our website for the new workshops coming through after the 1st of July.
Yes.
Okay, and then Steve, myself, and Peter Coppin will be heading off up to Muckenbuden for a special session. I think that's early afternoon we're doing that, on Thursday the 20th of June, and we'll be calling in, or at least probably just driving through with the time allotted to us, all places in between. If you're not sure where Muckenbuden is, it's not a new suburb of Perth, okay?
No,
it's in the north of Wheatbelt, so I don't think you're going to drive there for a little workshop because that could be fun, couldn't
it? Exactly right. And, of course, you can get all that information on our website, amongst other things on
our website. beyondgardens.com.au. There's a heap of resources there available to you.
Absolutely. And we don't shut it down when we have a bit of a break after Muckenbuden. It stays up there, so you can certainly access the social network sites. Have a look at our events calendar, because that will be updated through into June. Certainly have a good look through it and take advantage of it. It's all free.
So, once again, our sponsors who make this program possible are the Water Corporation, the City of Mandurah, the City of Stirling and the City of Swan, and we really do appreciate their strong support. We loved your company in the garden, and if it's Saturday, sorry you can't get in touch with us now. We've only got a couple more weeks to go, so take advantage of it. I'd like to thank my panellists tonight, have been terrific, John McWilliams and Steve McCabe. And of course, there is an expert crew behind the scenes whom you never see, but who get all this technology working, bring it all together, and somehow we create the big picture, which hopefully you're enjoying it now. We will do it all again next week. Until then, goodbye.